And okay, all right. So good morning, everybody. Welcome to lecture 26 of quantum mechanics part one. We have been talking about the quantum harmonic oscillator, and Ashutosh has a question he wants to ask. Go ahead, Ashutosh.
Sir, my question is from superposition principle. Sir, let's suppose there are three boxes with a different energy, and there is a three box. Single particle, according to superposition, a single particle can have in three different places at the same time. So my question was, how it is possible in really that at the same time a single particle can have at a different energy states?
Okay, one second. Okay, just give me one second. I'm going to change my network because again, I don't want to be disconnected. So let me switch to my mobile hotspot. Just take one second. Okay. So your question is what? That you have a single particle and you're asking that how can it be in three places? Huh?
Yes, sir. At the same time.
Right. Well, it's not in three places at the same time, no?
According to superposition principle,
yeah, but I mean, when you make a measurement, how? No, but
before measurement.
So before measurement, do you know where it is?
No, sir. Exactly, we do not
know.
No, but
you don't know,
we speak about probability at a different.
You don't. No, no. So before measurement, you don't have any knowledge, na?
Yes, sir.
You don't have any knowledge. Now, if I ask, let's see. Who is here who I have not seen before? If I ask where is Ashutosh?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now I know that you are in on campus because I can recognize that.
But sir, I am a classical particle, not a quantum particle.
No, what makes you think you are a classical particle? Where does that prejudice come from?
I think size.
No, there's no such thing. No such thing at all. No, I mean, it doesn't matter whether it's a classical particle or a quantum particle, right? Quantum mechanics is about asking questions of systems. So I ask question, where is Ashutosh? Right?
Yes.
And what can I say if I don't know where you are? What can I say? I can't say anything, no?
Yes,
you could
sir.
Be anywhere, no?
Yes, sir.
You could be anywhere in the universe.
Right, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir. But the interpretation, what is given in many books, that a single particle will be at a different places at the same time, according
which,
to superposition.
Which book?
Sir, Griffith and Jetley.
I thought just one minor point. It is Jetley, not Jetley.
Okay, so sir.
Pronunciation, may I know. It's but just because it's easy to confuse the two. See, a quantum state, right, is a statement about our lack of knowledge of an information. Okay, now when you make a statement of the form that a particle is in three different positions, right, that statement is not valid because see, in that statement what you are saying is that you know that the particle is at position A and B and C. Right, but you don't know that. You don't have that knowledge. Right? What is the knowledge you have? You have the knowledge that the state was prepared in such a way, right? And that is some knowledge that you do have, right? Because if you didn't have that knowledge also, then you can't say anything about the particle at all. It could be anything. So you prepared the state, or somebody prepared the state, so that the particle was in a ends up in a superposition of three different states. Now, first of all, you should think of these three positions as three different states, and not think of position any differently from any other property of a system. Whether it, you know, you look at some object, you say it has some color, it has some size, it has some shape, it has some contents, anything, any characteristic, any property. It has some position, it has some momentum. It doesn't matter, right? Any such property is the answer of some question that you can ask the system, na? Right? Like I can ask, you know, what is this person's name? Is this a person? Right? Is this object human being? These are all properties, right? Is this system at this location? That is a property. And so each property is associated with a state. Now, states can have some overlap with each other, right? So for instance, if I look at this object, right, and I say, what is the color, right? And I assign some color to this. Now, there can be two different states. One can be where it is red, and one can be where it is pink. But there can be some overlap between the two, no? Because it need not be completely uniformly red and uniformly pink. Right? So in such a case, we would say that these two states are not orthogonal to each other. But if they are orthogonal, it means there is no overlap, right? Means we can distinguish, an observer can look at the system and distinguish between property, one value of the property of the system and the other value. So if anybody asks, is this red or pink? After measurement, they can give a definite answer. Yes, it is either red or pink. There is no overlap. Now, when we look at this position, we say that each position, each point on the real axis is a independent state. So there is no overlap between x and x plus delta. Right? How do we represent that in terms of a state? We represent that as a delta function, right? Because a delta function is peaked at a single point. So somebody prepares a state and tells you that this state, the particle is at the superposition of position A, position B, and position C, right? Or any other property, that this system is in a superposition of color red and color blue and color green, or this coin is in a superposition of heads and tails. Okay. Then, do you know that it is in that superposition? First of all, no, you don't. What do you have to do? What is the
next experiment?
You have to perform the measurement.
Yeah.
So it's like I'm a blind person and somebody has given me this object and they're saying that it is red, blue, and green. I'm like, okay, sure, if you say so. But until I open my eyes, right, whether or not that person is correct or whether that knowledge is correct, I have no way of verifying. So I have to perform an experiment, a measurement. That measurement brings some information from this system to this system, right? And so this system gains some information. When this system gains some information, what the information do I gain? Do I gain information about the superposition when I perform a measurement?
No. After measurement,
After measurement, what happens?
Now, single state we will find. Like
you
either
will find
head or
us
tail.
Either head or tail, no?
Yeah.
Can you tell after one measurement whether, so you write the state as some superposition alpha heads plus beta tail. After one measurement, can you tell what are the values of alpha and beta?
No, sir.
No, right? What do you need to do to determine the values of alpha and beta?
We will perform several experiments, and on the basis of
you
that,
will need many copies of that same state.
Yes.
Right? Technically, you need an infinite number of copies. Okay. So, and then for each copy, you perform the same measurement again and again and again. You find that it is heads 50% of the time and tails 50% of the time. And then you can say, okay, alpha is 1 by root 2 and beta is 1 by root 2. Right?
Yes, yes,
but is that all the information about the system?
No.
What is missing? Is there something that is missing? Alpha and beta are complex numbers, right? In general?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So there could also be a complex phase, a relative phase. So we have not determined that. So one has to do some different type of measurements to perform to determine that complex phase. Now coming back to your statement about a particle being in three positions at the same time.
Yes, sir.
It is not in three positions at the same time. It is in a state which is a superposition of three positions. When you perform a measurement, you get a result that it is in position A or position B or position C.
Yes, it means the particle will be either of one, two, or three states before the measurement.
Yes.
We don't know.
After the measurement, you will get a result. The result will tell you that it is either in A or B or C.
Okay, sir. And sir, what about after the measurement, we find a Dirac delta. So what about remaining two states? If we find a particle in a psi 1, then what about psi 2 and psi 3? The wave function, like where the wave function will go?
So what you are asking, right, is, like I said, I mentioned this in an earlier lecture, right, that this is called the problem of measurement. Because it's something that we have not fully understood yet. Right? This collapse, right? That the state collapses to one eigenstate. This is a mysterious process. Okay? Some people will tell you that no, there is no mystery. We understand it. There is XYZ interpretation or this interpretation or that interpretation of quantum mechanics according to which, everything makes perfect sense, right? But I think the majority of physicists, quantum physicists, if you ask them, they will tell you that, look, we have no idea what's going on. Okay. So this is an open problem. It's one of the most fundamental problems in physics. What is this collapse? Where do, in your words, where do these other states go? Quote unquote, right?
Yes.
Where does that information vanish? Right? We are still trying to figure out. So this is the reason that, if you all might remember, if any of you have like read any of the history, that Einstein was not very fond of quantum mechanics. Right?
Yeah.
Now quantum mechanics developed in large part due to Einstein's own work, because Einstein described the photoelectric effect, right? The photoelectric effect,
yes.
That description involves the introduction of the idea of a quantum of light, right? So Planck had first suggested that light should come in these small particles, small packets. Then Einstein showed that in order to explain the photoelectric effect, if you make this assumption, then you can explain everything about the photoelectric effect. Then after that, there was other work. Bohr came along some years later and said that the energy levels of the atom can be described in this way. Then Sommerfeld came along and gave an explanation for why Bohr's method works, right? So, and then there were other developments slowly. But once quantum mechanics proper developed, that is matrix mechanics and wave mechanics were developed by Schrodinger and Heisenberg and others, Jordan and Born, very good, thank you. You have actually read some of the history. And so at that point in time, Einstein was not very happy, right? Because he said this, he made this very famous statement, right? That God does not play dice with the universe, right? Matlab, if I say that in Hindi, Bhagwan prakriti ke saath jua nahi khelta, right? So in other words, that there is some complete theory of reality, and quantum mechanics is a part of that description, and we don't yet know what that complete theory of reality is. When we know that complete theory, we will understand this measurement process and everything. Okay, now there are many physicists who believe that, hold that, you know, opinion. But there are many other physicists who believe that no, that's it, quantum mechanics, this is it. We will never really know anything beyond the quantum state. We have the quantum state of a system, and we have this probability distribution description, and we will never know anything beyond this. This is the limit of our knowledge, right? So they're saying that, well, you are wasting your time looking for some theory of reality in which everything can be known, right? So anyways, I've gone into this little bit of philosophical discussion because I think maybe many of you might have such questions or such doubts in your mind, right? And I just wanted to like give you some perspective on this. Does this do anything to clear up any of your doubts, Ashutosh? I don't know.
Yes, sir. First question, I have cleared my doubt.
This is only the first question. Tell me.
The second question was about the collapse of the state. As you told that this is open challenge. So,
okay.
I don't know.
I also don't know. No, but if you have a question, you can ask me. Okay. If I know the answer to that question, I'll give you the answer. If I don't, I'll tell you I don't know. So what is your question?
Sir, everything is done.
Your function has collapsed into one state. Okay. All right. Then I will continue with the harmonic oscillator. Again, if anybody does have questions, you please feel free to interrupt me and ask. Okay. All right. So in what have we understood so far about the harmonic oscillator? We have understood the following. That we can start with some Hamiltonian, which looks like this, right? And then what we can do is, I always forget. And then we can rescale the Hamiltonian. We can rescale it. And write it in this way, where omega is equal to root k by m, And these quantities are dimensionless. Once we have done this, we can define two operators, A and A dagger, right? Which are respectively known as annihilation and creation operators. And once we define these two operators, then we can rewrite the Hamiltonian I in the following way: H bar omega A dagger A plus 1/2. And I'm not put hats on this. Again, it's understood what is an operator, what is not. Okay. Sometimes I forget to put hats on something. And here A and A dagger have a commutation relation that this is the identity. Then we define the number operator. What is the number operator? It's A dagger. And so from the Schrodinger equation, which is H bar, the time independent Schrodinger equation, from this, we can see that A dagger A acting on psi is equal to E divided by H bar omega minus 1/2 times psi. So psi is an eigenstate of this number operator with an eigenvalue given by this expression. So we label the states of psi, we label the states with some number n, which is the eigenvalue. Small n is the eigenvalue of this big N operator, and we label the eigenstate with this, right? And then we can show that n, first of all, n has to be always greater than or equal to zero. Right, we can prove that by so n is the eigenvalue of this operator, right? So we say A dagger A psi n is equal to n psi n. We take the inner product of both sides with psi n. We use the properties of the scalar product and the fact that this can be written as another scalar product, because this part is the adjoint of this part, right? So as I showed you in the other day in class, right, you can write it in this way, and you can write this A times psi of n as some state phi. So this whole expression becomes the scalar product of phi, the norm of phi. The norm of phi also always has to be positive definite. So on the left side, you get the norm of some state phi. On the right side, you get n times the norm of some state psi. And both of these norms have to be greater than zero. That means that n also has to be greater than zero. Then you can use, you can determine, we can calculate the commutation relations of this operator with A and A dagger. When we do this, what we find is that A acting on psi of n gives us a state which has one, which has one eigenvalue less, and A dagger acting on psi of n gives us a state which is one value more, right, where n is the eigenvalue of this number operator. So what we are doing is we have some ladder of states, right, where the steps of this ladder represent the eigenstates of this number operator. And if I act with a dagger, I go up the steps. If I act with A, I go down the steps. Okay. Now, so what does A do? A decreases the eigenvalue of psi, right? So that means if I act on psi of n, the eigenvalue goes from n to n minus 1. So now what I can, but I already know that n cannot be greater than or cannot be less than 0. So what I find is that there has to be some state psi 0 for which A should give me 0. Because otherwise, what will happen is I can have negative eigenvalues. N can go to negative values. That is not allowed. So this is called the ground state of my system. This is the ground state, right? And then furthermore, once I know this, then I know that N can take the following values, right? Why? Because I've already seen that if I act with A dagger, N always increases by 1. So once I know that the lowest eigenvalue is 0, that means the next one has to be 1 and then 2 and then 3 and 4. Now, what is N? N is this object, right? So what this tells me is that E by h bar omega minus 1/2 is equal to N, where N is some positive integer, which tells me that the possible eigenvalues of the system have this form, right? So this is the spectrum of the equation of the system. These are the energy eigenstates. And once I have this equation, I can solve this equation explicitly for psi naught by taking the expression for A dagger, acting on this state psi naught. This gives me a differential equation. When I solve that differential equation, then I get, so I write psi naught in the position basis, and then I take the inner product. If we put x prime over here, I take the inner product of this x with this whole expression. Right? This is 0. Now there are two terms in this. One term involves x, operator x, psi naught. Right? What is this going to be? This is just going to be equal to psi naught x. You can check this very easily by acting with x hat on this expression. You will get, it's going to be x times psi naught x. And similarly, x and the second term p hat psi naught is equal to minus i h bar d by dx psi naught x. So I get a differential equation, which is the following. I get this differential equation for psi naught. I can easily solve this differential equation, and that differential equation gives me that psi of naught x is equal to some normalization times exponent minus m omega by 2 h bar x squared, right? What is this? This is a Gaussian. I can write this as exponent minus x square by alpha square, where alpha square is equal to 2h by m omega, and alpha is the width of my distribution, width of this function, this Gaussian. Right? So if I calculate delta x, which is equal to the expectation value of x hat square, so I should say square over here, square root over here, square root here, I get alpha. So the ground state of my system looks like this. If I very, very difficult for some reason to draw a symmetric shape. So this is my Gaussian. Again, not happy with that. Let me try one more time. Okay, I'll have to be happy with this. Just move it up a little bit. And this has a width, right? Which is this. Delta x is actually the square root of this. Delta x is equal to alpha. So this is my ground state of my. What is the potential now? What is the, remember that we are in a potential. Yes, question, Panja?
Yes, sir.
Question?
Yes, question, sir. The width of the Gaussian alpha, exactly where do we measure it, sir?
We measure it along the real axis?
No, like in the Gaussian, so we can even measure the in the center exactly, or we go a little bit lower or lower, or it's arbitrary, we can measure it anywhere. The width alpha from the graph.
No, so the width is has a very, very precise definition, right? Like I said, it's this object, right? Delta x, it's the uncertainty in x. So the uncertainty in x is. Is this expression right?
So if we are given right? A Gaussian and
once again, this is the expression for the uncertainty. Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Now this is zero because it's symmetric around the x-axis. So this is expectation value of x squared. How do you calculate this expectation value of x squared? This will turn out to be x squared sine of x squared dx, right?
Yes, sir.
Right, and when you do this calculation, you will find that this will turn out to be equal to alpha squared. I might be missing a factor of 1/2. If I am, please forgive me. So now, what is your question, Panja?
Like we can't find this delta x from the graph itself. Like we can't look at a graph and say this is measuring something on the graph.
I'm looking at the graph now. But so if you're asking what is the exact location of these
exact
points?
Location exactly.
So well, the exact location that much precision I don't have now visually.
So we can't measure it from the graph, right, sir? Exactly.
No, you can. You can measure it from the graph because it turns out to be uh, Well, you can measure it from the graph if you have a ruler and a pencil. And the way it works is that so Panja, I don't know if you have a question or if you're testing me.
No, I'm not testing
my knowledge. I don't know. So you have to measure, this is the point which divides the two sides of the expression into, there is some ratio of the probability here and here,
this was my question.
From statistical, bhai to na Panja, I knew you were testing me. So,
no, sir.
Theek hai. So, this is, it's okay, man. I used to test my professors too. I mean, after all, if you don't test your professors, then how do you know they're actually worthy of being your professors, right? Nahin? Kaise pata chalega aapko? कि उनको कुछ आता है कि नहीं आता. No, but seriously, I hope that I've answered your question, okay? But if I have not to tell me, I'll try to ask, clarify.
I thought it like an electronics, when we have a graph like this, we take peak value, divide by root 2, we get 2 points, we measure, we call that like quality factor or something. I was expecting.
Say that
is
again.
There something here too? Instead of electronics, when we get something like measuring the quality factor, take the peak.
So
value,
you're right. Why? It's exactly the same thing. It's the quality factor. बिल्कुल सही, बिल्कुल सही पकड़ रहे हैं आप. You're absolutely right. So you have some signal, and it has some height and it has some width, right? Delta F and F naught. Then we define the quality factor. What is the quality factor? It is F naught divided by delta F, na?
Yes, sir.
Now in this case, what will be the quality factor? In this case, the quality factor will be F naught is the value of the state at zero, which will be the normalization this thing constant, right?
Yes.
Divided by delta F. Delta F is what? Alpha.
Alpha.
Right. So what is the quality factor of this state? You tell me. Okay. What is N? You can calculate that and let me know.
Okay.
Okay. Any other questions? And so for a Gaussian, will this quality factor depend on alpha? Suraj?
Sir?
What is the dimension of alpha? What is the dimensionality of alpha?
X squared.
What is the dimension of X?
Position.
L, length.
Length.
So what is the dimension of alpha?
L, position.
L. Is Q dimensionless or dimensionful?
Q is dimension.
Is Q dimensionless or does it have dimension?
It's so dimensionless.
It's dimensionless. Now it's one frequency divided by another frequency.
Yes, another frequency.
Right. So this also has to be dimensionless.
Yes, sir.
So this N has to have dimensions of length.
Length.
So N can only be proportional to alpha.
Yes, sir.
So alpha will cancel out and Q will not depend on alpha. Q will be a constant.
Will be a constant.
Right. So for a Gaussian, Q is just a constant.
Just a constant.
Whatever it is, 1 or 1 half or whatever it comes out to be, 1 by root 2.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Any other question? Okay. So this is the algebraic method. This is the Dirac method. And the beauty of this method is that we did not have to solve any differential equations. We did not even have to worry about the form of these wave functions. We didn't need to know that. Simply from the knowledge of the commutators, we can determine and the properties of quantum states that they are, that the scalar product is a positive definite number. We can determine that the eigenstates, the eigenenergies are given by this expression. And now there are still a couple of things that we have not determined yet. Okay, one of them is the following. Is that when I act on this nth eigenstate with A, right, I get something that is proportional to n minus 1, right? So the question is, what is the proportionality constant? So if I write A psi n is equal to some, let's say, C n minus 1, what is this? What is this coefficient, right? Right. And similarly, if I act with A dagger on psi n, I get some coefficient, let me call that d n plus 1. Or actually, it would be better to call this c n. Guys, just give me 1 second, okay? Hold on.
All right, so I will leave this for the next class. Right now, I have to go, and I'm sure you all have to go also. Okay? So if there are any questions, please share them with me on Telegram or email or any other source, okay? And before you all go, can you say hi once?
Hi.
One second. Hi. Light went just as she came here. Okay. None of you can turn your videos on. To say hi to a little girl.
Hi.
Heartless people.
Hi.
अब सबके वीडियोस ऑन हो गए फटाक से. हाँ, पहले नहीं काम कर रहे थे. ठीक, चलो. Okay. Bye bye. I will see you all tomorrow.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.